Yeah, the I could think of a host of other people that should be here talking to you, but I think it's just you and me. Most of the sort of senior fellows have headed off, and so it's really just the student body. I noticed how everybody came up and they sat here and started off by saying, it's been a real pleasure to be invited. Yeah, nothing could be further from the truth in my case. I hauled my ass across from the United Kingdom yesterday in a coach class ticket, yeah, which is how you all do your stuff, yeah? One of my absolute rules in retirement is never travel in anything but the front of the plane, yeah? And I have to break it every time I do anything with the Americans. The answer is, you stuck my ass in seat number 13, which really sets the tone for the sort of what I call the day as it is. I really enjoyed the bugles and that bloody cannon banging off last night when I got here well last night. So it's anything but a bloody pleasure to be here, quite honestly. Oh, and I noticed that, in fact, on general order as issued by George Washington that said profanity was something that, in fact, so I will try and reduce the profanity, which I normally, in effect, fill up most of my lectures with, which normally end up being about a 10-minute shot with about 50 minutes worth of all those other words you can't use here in America because it'd be politically incorrect. For a few of you who may have crossed me and know me, my deepest apologies. For you who didn't, then I salute your good fortune. This is really just about a look at this. And I sense that bit isn't unimportant. We're 100 years on from 1914. One of the great books, and if you've never read it, and I read very few books, yeah, I came out of education at 17, went straight into the army, only had a Scottish higher, so have no university education, though I do find myself teaching at Yale University, although in fact they're just gusting along with Stan McChrystal, so a bit like here, I tend to be just the light entertainment. But one of the great books that if you have not read it, you should do, is called Storm of Steel by Ernst Jungen, who was the epitome of the German stormtrooper. Hugely disappointed in 1918 when the war finished. Yeah, it was a sense of complete duty. It defined his experience and his life up, and in many ways to that point in time. He was seriously wounded 14 times, you know, shot through lung and arm type wounding. Yeah, not just clipped, but serious wounds. He lived to about 101, 102, which says a great deal about his steadfastness and robustness, which you would recognize here in the audience. But he was interviewed when he was about 98, and the interviewer turned around and said, Ernst, you know, you've had a full life, and it's basically closing. You know, what would you wish to the future, to the youth, and what would be your advice to those who are going out after you're dead? And his comment was, why would I give a damn? I'll be dead. And it resonates here. Because what matters is it's all about behind whatever it is, the first two or three rows, it's all about y'all. We, here in the front, me in particular, yeah, the Stan McChrystals, the Marty Dempseys, the Ray Ordianas, we'll be dead or we will have gone on to sitting our asses out, sitting on some swing seat, drinking beer, playing golf if you want to be really, really dull, snowboarding or whatever the case may be, yeah? But the truth is, that where you are now is absolutely critical to the future, yours, our nation's future, your children's children's future. And if you don't recognize that, you really should not be in this room. And so what I'm going to try and do, having not been here for the last 3 days, is pull together some thoughts, some which resonated with the panels this morning. You know, these are powerful speakers you've had. They really know what they're talking about. Yeah, I don't. But the truth of the matter is some of it resonates across in many ways. And I'll try and pull together what I think to be those which are about this question here, in effect, confronting the world as it is. Who's in charge of the clattering train? The axles creak and the coupling strain. The pace is hot and the points are near, and sleep has deadened the driver's ear, and the signals flash through the night in vain, for death is in charge of the clattering train. The year is 1936. Winston Churchill, no stranger to conflict, campaign, or war. South Africa, Mexico, Afghanistan, the Great War, both as a minister, and then after the Dardanelles, into the trenches. Winston finds himself ridiculed, isolated, pushed to the back benches in 1936, desperately trying to have his world, Parliament, and the people of Great Britain recognize that a storm is coming, and no one is listening. Later on, in his books, he wrote three great books on the war, having then completed the Second World War. In the 1950s, his first, which then looked back at that period of the 1930s, which he referred to as the cover as the Gathering Storm, the theme of which was how the English-speaking people, through their unwisdom, carelessness, and good nature, allowed the wicked to rearm. What is really interesting in his that very precise theme to this book was his accusing finger was not pointed at Germany, of which he had demanded and enforced with Jarl an unconditional surrender on Lüneburg Heath on the 8th of May, 1945. His accusing finger was pointed at those who could have done something about the world that was there in their face, and they did not. They failed to match up to the plate, whatever you want to refer to it as, but they singly failed to see what was coming. And history is littered with examples. Edmund Burke was a great one. The only thing necessary for the triumph of evil is that good men, and I would include good women, should do nothing. A later referral was when the bad combine, the good must associate, or they will fall one by one in an unpitied sacrifice in a contemptible struggle. Francis Bacon, later on, things will alter for the worst spontaneously if they are not altered for the better designedly. Our history, your history, is littered with reasons to have considered at a time when, in plain sight, what you should have done, what you should have reflected on, what you should have done, you did not do. And do not assume that we're smart enough to figure it out. You've got to love Albert. Yeah? He is such a top bloke. Yeah? He's got some fantastic quotes out there. The one that also applies, I think, when he turned around and said, he's asked the question, if you had 60 minutes to save the world, what would you do? His answer was he'd spend the first 55 minutes defining the problem and the last 5 minutes finding a solution. My experience of 38 years of life, and actually, in fact, the last 6 or 7, is that I find people spending the first 59 minutes desperately trying to find a solution, and the last minute blaming everyone else. But finally, to Albert, a note of caution which is applicable to me and your own reflections on whatever you want to take away, violently agree, disrespectfully disagree. I really don't give a damn about what I have to talk about, but please have a view. Was when he turned around and said, whosoever sets himself up as a judge of knowledge and truth is shipwrecked by the laughter of the gods. Yeah? So the truth of the matter is that this is just my opinion. This is a view I have on the world, confronting it as I see it. Is it right? Is it wrong? Obviously, it's pretty wrong. Yeah? But there'll be some resonances in there which really do matter. Now, here's a really interesting bit of mathematics in the underside. You'll recognize these two legends, yeah? I've worked with both of them. I mean, just great Americans in the truest sense. Yeah, General Schumacher, yeah, the son of a bitch. I was having to buy him a drink in 2004 when he describes to me, and I can't remember the exact equation, but he talks about what the American military is. And he has the sort of what I call, you know, the equipment, the structure, the organization, the doctrine, and he says it's all to the power of TE squared, 2004. So the power of all of those pieces, the stuff, the mechanics, some of the underlying doctrine, which is better than that, yeah, is about training, education, and experience. I have a conversation with General Mattis. You know, just a wonderful fella. Yeah, I have the utmost respect for both these two. I have a conversation with General Mattis in 2008, 4 years later. And he describes roughly the same sort of pile of stuff, equipment, structure, organizations, doctrine, you know, the gizmos in there, yeah? Yeah, you have a lot of them. We have very few because you stole our empire. Real shame. And we want Florida back sometime. I do some work with the Duke of Westminster. He really would like it back, yeah? I think actually, in fact, Russia might buy back Alaska, or they might want to take it at some point in time, but that was a good deal. But 4 years later, he comes up with EI squared. And that is to the power of experienced instinct and intuition. The difference is 4 years of combat. So y'all are absolutely in this space. Your instincts, your intuition, your experiences put you in a place where you defy Albert Einstein's logic of the universe is unpredictable, but stupidity is in fact beyond any doubt. You have the ability to reflect, to think, to consider deeply on what you've heard, because you are not like most of us or most of the speakers over the age of 45. I think it was Gorbachev who said anyone over the age of 45 cannot have a novel thought because we are the sum of our experiences. Now, I would challenge that a little bit, but there is an element of truth in that. Boney Fuller turned around and said, generals shouldn't be over the age of 40. And there's some truth in that too. So there is some strength in where you're all at. And it's really important, therefore, these last 3 days are not about just listening, about hearing what you think, oh, yes, that matters, and that's how I should apply something. But it's actually setting the conditions of reflecting, discussing, in order to do something with that. The fella here, who I can't remember his face, because General Jim asked me to go and do some work on the Joe when he was running GIFCOM, and I ran one of the classified scenarios. Was a brilliant fellow from MIT. He had the head the size of a planet. He seemed to have a brain about the size of the universe. Was a really, really clever guy. He talked to us for about 40 minutes. I was absolutely wasted at the end of that. You won't be, because I'm, in fact, pretty simple, and there's nothing really too much to say. But this guy knew what he was talking about. But at the end of it, what I said, I think what he's just told me is simply this. The next 3 to 5 years is all about innovation and integration. Take what you've got and be smarter with how you use it, and you get use from it. I sense in your current fiscal position, by the way, welcome to my world that was Britain. Yeah? The truth of the matter is that fiscal pressure puts you absolutely into that space. When he looked out to 2025, he said it's all about invention and discovery. Of which the initial thought would be, well, there's nothing we can do about that because we don't know what's yet invented or to be discovered. That would be the wrong assumption from that statement. The right assumption would be that whatever you do, a bit like the Kaiser Chiefs' latest album, yeah, education, 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 and war, yeah, what you must do is invest in you, in your people. So wherever you are, whatever part of the program you're involved in, hardware can come and go. Technology can be there, can be used, adjusted, whatever the case may be. What you must not do or allowed to be happen on your watch, because it is your watch, is for people to not invest and heavily in what is in here. And Jim Mattis has said that many times. What matters on the battlefield is the 6 inches, that between your two damn ears. But experience, and you've got a lot of it, isn't quite enough. What a splendid fellow, eh? Yeah, William Pearson, trumpeter. Yeah, chest load of campaign medals, yeah? A man of significant character. Because 160 years ago, he was one of those who went absolutely up the wrong damn valley. Yeah? And got shredded. His experience, considerable. But it's not enough. You'll recognize the uniform. Most of you will probably recognize the young officer. And that is one of the most insightful quotes, comments, opinions that I've ever read. Darwin wasn't wrong. Yeah, it's not the species that's the strongest. It's not the species that is the most intelligent, and you're not short of both of those. It's the species that's really good looking like me. No, the answer is it's the species that adapts. Yeah, the species that adapts that survives. Because change is absolutely coming, and you have to embrace it. Captain Sir Basil Littlehart, you know, the only harder thing getting a new idea into the military mind is getting the old one out. But George Clemenceau made a very interesting comment when he turned around and said that war was too important to be left to generals, and he was absolutely right. The corollary is that peace is too important to be left to politicians. I absolutely get and have never misunderstood the relationship you all have, whether you're American or a Brit or whichever other forces you represent, between where you are and your political authority. But the idea that only the bright ideas come from your political authority, who have a host of other tasks and reasons to concentrate on the delivery of that vast canvas they find themselves on, requires you to be straight and straightforward. It requires you to have been thoughtful, reflective, and to have got your mind around the reality. Not the defense of your service, not the defense of a particular company, but got your mind around what it is to be sitting where you are in defense of your realm. It's people, your prosperity, and its way of life. Because Tennyson, Alfred Lord, was right on the 25th of October, 1854, when he wrote that. I do not believe his comments to be right as they apply here in 2014. Because if you do not reply, and if you do not reason why, then that responsibility, whether it's within your constitution or the Declaration of Independence, or within the responsibilities you have as an officer holding the rank you do, to defend your realm against all those other pressures, the near-term pressures of politics, of popularity, of vanity, of money, of things that matter, but to have your voice heard and clearly, not bluntly and we just want more, but articulated in a way that understands the nature of the space you're in, not the nature, the space you are at. If you defend the past, you will certainly lose the future, is absolutely crucial. So, you've had 3 days looking at, and there's no good here, there's no bad, they're all just plain ugly. You'll notice most of them have mustaches. Yeah? I never really was taken by the mustache myself, but the intent and capability, threat, dictators, ideology, known threats, empire, ideology, religion, terror, conventional, unconventional. And what you've done is you've looked at what you have, structure, organization, doctrine, troops, capability to task, and you've listened to how you take those, you overmatch information superiority, technological advantage, training, quality and quantity, symmetric, asymmetric, conventional, unconventional, force against force, ready to face the world as it is or as you recognize it. Troops to task, fit for purpose. But how different is this century from the last? I would suggest, actually, quite different. That was the basis on which we managed information in the 20th century. Need to know. 9/11 came along, and immediately we recognized that one of the reasons that that attack had occurred was because we had not shared information. And you look at the Madrid bombing, 220 people killed, government changed, a litany of inefficiencies where information was not tracked from one place across the other. So we went to a need to share. Without the boundaries, without the controls, without the sort of spaces I remember during the first Gulf War, the difficulty of getting just stuff around bloody Riyadh. We opened it up here, saying this is the new age, and we got Assange, and we got Snowden. And where do we find ourselves now? Probably in a space which is called who to blame. And we don't know how to undo that. The implications for all your spaces, we talked about synergy, we talked about the interagency, you talked about the joint force, bring all those pieces together. If you cannot share your information, if you are not confident, trust in that information being held and managed in a way, then the answer is you're in a bad space and you won't share it. If you don't share it, then trust me, where we were on 9/11 is just about, or is already probably, not in a great place. We were in a space of collective defense. NATO. We drew together as big nations or large alliances, confronted empire superpowers, Cold Wars, real wars, call it what you will. Increasingly, what I sense is one of national security. Common interests work across, but invariably it starts with the selfish, self-interested interest. That's not to dismiss and say, you know, we want to go back to what was. It's just to recognize what is. And we are towards the... We went from that to an interesting space now of globalization and multinationals. Let me give you an example. If my foreign secretary wants to go and visit, let's say, for instance, an African state, he, of course, can do it. It would take about maybe 3 weeks to 3 months to organize. He would arrive there, be met with due authority. He would fly down in a commercial jet. He would have an audience with the president, prime minister, whoever it may be. They would talk some trade issues. They would talk about some substantive issues. He would then go and see probably what the British Council was doing, and then he would return home. His access, 100%. His leverage, probably less than 10. If the CEO of a large multinational wants to go in and see that same said president or prime minister, he'll go down in 3 days, he'll fly in a private jet, he'll go in there privately, have a discussion, he'll leave. His access, 100%. His leverage, I don't know, somewhere between 20, 30, 40. Recognizing where power, spheres of influence, you know, it's how empires were built, were, but how it has changed matters. Matters a great deal. Because what we had was situational awareness. That's what that was the Holy Grail, you know. How much ammunition has the ship got? What's its status? Where's the fuel? How quick it's going? What is the damage to it? Da-di-da-di-da. What we need in this century is situational understanding. That is a completely different level. That goes back to what we as old empire used to see with political officers, with our colonial service. The sort of people that got in the way of young Winston when he was desperate to go and close and kill Afghan tribesmen who were saying no. This was just a misunderstanding. It was just part of life. Our cultural understanding, in most cases, is really crap. We've got better in certain spaces, specific to the task. We enjoyed a century of probably broad order, terrible order, troubled order, whatever you want to call it. What I see increasingly is a century of disorder, one of uncertainty rather than certainty. And then the last point. In previous centuries, only army, navies, air forces, marine corps could deliver industrial violence. In this century, just a few can. Just a few can deliver that which was, in fact, held by the Westphalian Pact model nation-state, 1649, right through to today, now to be delivered by just a few. And there's no sense or shortage of demented, violent, extremist, radical, just plain lunatics out there who have the wherewithal to bring some of that to bear. Within that, you have a world that is now not informed, but is increasingly connected. Mr. BlackBerry, Mr. Internet, Mr. iPad, iPhone. You know, Saudi have the most tweeters, I think, in the nation, in across the nation states. Are connected, but not necessarily informed. When Theodore Roosevelt went to the Sorbonne in 1910, he gave that great talk when he talked about the critic, it's the man in the arena, not the critic. You go on, he talks about journalism, the fourth estate. And he says, a force for great good or a force for infinite mischief. Your ability to, in fact, do and conduct information operations, mischief operations, call it what you will, to be able to engender passion, anger, emotion on your iPhone. to be able to shock as you saw someone's head off, as you butcher them in public, whatever it may be, these have got real reach, global reach. And then you finally have weapons of mass, not destruction. I'm more concerned about weapons of mass disorder. Power, electricity, logistics, the essential parts of our life which we just take for granted. You know, in Britain, when we had, I think, a fuel strike recently, you know, we were suddenly looking at a position where, in fact, it would have been quite difficult for the country to sustain itself if it had continued for many more days, because everything is just in time. It's based upon a system which you all recognize as logisticians, or, you know, the art of war is logistics, nothing's ever changed there, but actually that which can be brought to bear. So you have, in this space, the power of just one. That is a very different century that you now find yourselves in. Whether that's a good thing, whether it's a bad thing, my view is just recognize it for what it is. But it ain't going anywhere time soon. So what do we know? Well, here we go. We need to get our mind right. Well, we know that's not unmanned. It just hasn't got a damn pilot. It's got a shedload of people. I don't know, 82. Depends, you go to Global Hawk, about 140, something like that, yeah? You've got a beltload of people. Weathermen, legal, managing that thing. Oh, by the way, and the space it's flying over, that's certainly not ungoverned. My experience is there is no such thing in this world as ungoverned space. You know, you go out and go to Mali, yeah, then they have a conversation with a Tuareg. They know exactly who owns what, and that implies not only to the land that, in fact, you're grazing on top, also to, in fact, actually the water that sits underneath it. It's just governed not as we would expect it or would necessarily recognize it. But we tend to glance at some of these things and think differently. Now, Secretary Donald Rumsfeld got in a lot of trouble when he went about the known, unknown, known, knowns and all the rest, yeah? Laughed out of court, yeah? This Persian poet wrote this a long, long time ago. Preceded Donald Rumsfeld by five centuries. Actually, what your Secretary of State was saying was something which actually was quite insightful, because we get, and in many ways the last 3 days have been about the top bit. You've probably got an insight to the second and may have nailed it, so you can take your lame donkey to its destination. And you probably, without recognizing it, may have got some insights to the last. And in there lies the challenge for you all. Because nothing's quite as we think it is. Arab Spring. Yeah, classic. Great photograph, love it. I just quickly went across Tunisia and Egypt, yeah. End of the day, not all those will be right. It's one man's effort, research, all my own thoughts. Yeah, that was a rough list of reasons, the underlying causes why you had, in fact, what I call trouble on the streets. Yeah, you can't draw a piece of paper between difference. So was it about a race towards democracy? No, it wasn't. It was about a failure of the social contract. It's Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Oh, and if that is the case, and I believe it to be the case, and I may not be absolutely right, but I reckon I'm probably in the right sort of space area, yeah? The truth of the matter is, it sure as hell doesn't apply to 22 nations and 250 million people. It applies to London. It applies potentially to the United States. It applies to Greece, Athens, Spain, any one of the countries in question. But the failure of the social contract, the gap between authority and the people, the social space here, in many ways, is not healthy. And it will, if stressed, cause the sort of things you saw in London about whatever it was, 18 months ago, where suddenly the opportunity presents itself and people just turn up, assembly just turn up, there are no policemen in Toxteth, so they can all turn up in Toxteth. I fancy a 42-inch television. Switch the power off in Los Angeles and tell me what happens. Yeah? So don't just think it's a Brit thing. Yeah? Have a problem in New York, yeah? And see what happens. The social fabric out there is surprisingly thin. And if it falls over and breaks, trust me, it will significantly change or impact our way of life. $16 million, tragic event, pales into insignificance of which the low figure is 50 million and the upper figure is 100 million. And the interesting thing, while there is a great deal written about the Great War, is we still don't truly understand what the cause of this flu epidemic was, pandemic. Because unlike normal flus, this didn't attack the youth and the aged. It took out the 15 to 35-year-olds. Now, whether that was because of man inoculations, whether it was a man-made, or whether it was just the sum of a natural disorder, yeah, this thing tore the heart out of a world that wasn't connected, that was still had order and some social spacement within it. If you stress that into a 21st century world, I have no idea how it would end up. But what's interesting, Nick Bostrom did some work. He calls about bangs, crunches, shrieks, and whimpers as they look towards the sort of what I call, you know, things that could happen. And man-made or nature-made, pandemic was one of them. Volcanoes was another. Mega tsunamis was another one. Mr. Asteroid. Yeah, 2013, Chelyabinsk. Yeah, we know Chelyabinsk because it was the old, you know, the old good old bad days during the Russian, you know, a lot of nuclear interests out there. What's fascinating about that is, you know, we remember it as a light show. No one had any idea that thing existed until it entered the Earth's atmosphere. It was doing 42,000 miles an hour. It blew at 18.4 miles above the Earth's horizon and detonated with an energy strength of 500 kilotons. It was 20 meters wide. Now, I have no idea what it would have happened if it had smacked into the ground, it had made the distance, or it was a lot bigger. I'm not saying these things are likely. What I'm saying is they're not impossible. Carrington event, 1854, solar flare. Shut down the telegraph system across America, and that was about the only thing it could affect at the time. If you looked at it today, it would cause $2.7 trillion worth of damage. So man-made natural disasters, you see what tsunamis can do. You know, we know about the one off the Canary Islands. These things are not likely, but they're not impossible. And the social impact goes well beyond anything the first responders can deal with. If you cross over into man-made, the assumption is this is the worst thing that could happen. This is only number three, nuclear war. Number four was biotech. Number one in the man-made space, that which would end our way of life, not existential yet, but end our way of life or change it significantly as we know it, artificial intelligence. I mean, straight out of a science fiction movie. You know, remember Deep Blue? You know, everybody used to laugh at it. Yeah, I couldn't quite beat the old sort of, you know, your damn iPhone can beat any chess player now. Technology's got to a space where it's in a weird space and accelerating convergence. Who could have thought what you could do with 3D printing? And that's just a start. So when we talk about innovation and integration of whatever you've got out there, at the end of the day, you're absolutely in the right space. But these are real threats. They're not casual. Man-made climate change. 2 degrees in the Atlantic, ain't got a clue, yeah? Actually, climate change is the wrong term. Because all these things that I've just talked through here are all about instability. It's all about instability that we need to be worried about. It's less about security and it's more about stability. Because they're the underlying reasons why things, because what happens when you get, and we are getting, extreme weather, whether it's tornadoes across here, whether it's the south of England flooding back down there, whether you're looking at all the rest that is going on, who do they impact most? Well, it's not those nations which sit within the stable or sustained index. I think there are 52 nations out of the 193 or whatever index you want to run on, what numbers you want to run up with here within the global space. Only 52 sit within the stable and the sustainable space. United States of America and UK are only in stable. In alert and warning space are all the rest. So when you get an event like this, top left, bottom right, it rips the shit out of the nation state. And if that transfers across to a loss of a total crop, the implications are just significant. Global stability, globalization. We draw our resources, we get our energy from, we look towards the global enterprise as somewhere where we need to do business. That is just a very crude shape of what the stable state looks like. When I go around the world, I don't ask about often security, I ask about those first three. An expectation. And if the states are that, all's well. If it's like that, all is not well. And it is extremely difficult to adjust. And what breeds in this ground? Organized crime, terror, radical extremism, lunatics, shadow governments. It undermines the under-operating structure, which we all, the MS-DOS, which we've enjoyed since 1648. It really, really matters. Because if you do not attend to this, then a bit like this, this is an AIDS. And if you don't deal with it soon and quickly, and you leave it, at this point in time, you're dead men and women walking. And the similarities are worth reading across. And yet, for all those states, the vast majority which are sitting somewhere from about here over to here, rather than in this space, what we tend to do is we wait and wait and wait and wait, and we intervene here or engage at this point. And yet that is where we should intervene. We prepare the 5% people talked about in the little panels, yeah, for this part. The 95% sit over here. And if you do not think this is something which you should consider, think about. It is part of your responsibility in defense of your realm, your people, its prosperity, and its way of life. Because if the world breaks down increasingly into failing and failed states, into ungoverned, but they're not, criminal oligarchies, terror spaces, then your future cannot be defended just by the boundaries of your own realm. Very dull German. Yeah? Wrote 8 books which are almost unintelligible. Yeah? Carl Philipp Gottfried von Clausewitz. He didn't finish the damn sentence. He didn't finish the sentence. And my last thought to you is simply this. If war is the continuation of politics by other means to politics, it must return. Your placement in uniform is to contain, to do your nation's bidding, but to absolutely, before you cross the start line, understand the context, understand the situation, understand the cultures, understand what you are about to do over the way with all those other departments of state, the whole of government, and to politics it will return, is what you then set the conditions for. Play the video, could you?
Let's face the music and dance. Soon we'll be without the moon, humming a different tune, and then there may be teardrops to shed. So while there's moonlight and music and love and romance, let's face the music and dance, dance. Let's face the music and dance. There's
trouble ahead. I'll be dead, so I never intend to take up dancing. Thank you for your attention. I'll take any questions, and I'm sorry I banged on quite so long, but it's complicated shit. So.
Yeah, I'm Russell King, computer programmer, and you had mentioned the fact that our political leaders don't have all the good ideas, and I agree with that, and it sort of reminds me of something I read I believe it was the book Strategy by Basil Hart, and he was talking about the indirect approach as it applies to military tactics, but he said it also would apply to political tactics in the sense that you probe the political leader to make that leader permeable to the thrusts of truth. And as far as our candidates for president, I don't think we haven't declared, but undeclared presidential candidates, I won't go into any specifics, and also a lot of congressmen, quite often the military is not even an issue that they talk about publicly much at all. And I think there may be a couple reasons for it. One is that we only a small percentage of the American population is actively involved in the military, and also the public is largely war-weary. So I'm wondering how you could, what's the best way to influence the political leaders to make sure that politically it's viable for them to stress the military more now? Because I think their political advisors might say, well, you don't want to really get into that too much because there are other issues like health care and balancing the budget that's a lot more popular.
So, unsurprisingly, uber smart question. Goes back to, in fact, Alfred Lord Tennyson, right to reply to reason why. I do not think we right now, whether it's here on this side of the Atlantic or across on the other side of the Atlantic, have a clear understanding of what the narrative of what we do in place. Just polishing what was reiterating the need for what has been, in my view, will not be fit for purpose. What you need to do is articulate the reason why. The importance of that narrative does a number of things. One is that it forces into open the debate why the taxpayer should pay $550 billion for y'all. It forces into the debate what you do. It forces into the debate who you are, what culturally underpins you. It also forces into the debate the relationship between the American people and its armed forces. And if you just give them away a strap line that we're looking after your future upstream without describing how that fits into stabilizing a world to which their global interests lie, their goods are exchanged, the movement of resources, the implications of the loss of that space, and the like, then in many ways, you are struggling. What you have to do is present that narrative. If you get the narrative right, then you get the people. And the politicians will, in my experience, always be inclined to listen to the public voice. You're in a very strong position here in the United States of America. In many ways, you have, and rightly so, earned the respect, admiration of all your allies, but also respect and admiration of your own domestic audience. What's really important is you do absolutely nail to the lay person the reason why. And if you can't articulate it, then what the last panel was talking about in the way of cuts, sequestration, adjustments in your budget should not come as any form of a surprise. When General Petraeus and Ambassador Ryan Crocker, top dog fella, were coming back to go and talk to Congress about the surge in 2007, General Petraeus said, look, here's the slide deck. What do you think of it? My view is I said, hey, General, you've taken this down from about 890 slides down to about 8. Yeah, the murder boards are fantastic. It's really out in the market. There's nothing I can do. He said, so what are you saying? And all I said was, hey, General, it's your call. You'll do a great job here, but just talk straight through the hill. Talk to middle America. And I sense that part remains absolutely important. I'm not sure we have a strong narrative right now. And if you can't define and articulate a strong narrative, then you deserve not to get all that you want. It's a democratic society. You're expensive. Yeah, I enjoyed it in many ways. But you have to define where you fit into its needs, because health matters. In effect, what I call the domestic issues matter hugely. The economy matters. Welfare, support matter. That's what you're competing with. And you have to justify the need. The great monolithic threats in many ways have gone. The idea of global war and terror is sort of struggling through. But there are no end of clear and present dangers that will rip the heart out of your way of life and tear apart the global order. The responsibility for you to be able to intervene, engage overseas and early to help, to be able to intervene and engage where necessary, either aggressively and or in a helpful manner, on a natural disaster overseas matter. And oh, by the way, resilience back in the homeland matters too, because we have no idea what happens. Harold Macmillan once said, you know, what about politics? He said, it's events, dear boy, events. So we have no idea what those events will be, but we can foresee some of the challenges that you could face. So it's been a long 3 days. Thank you for listening. I don't think too many people went to sleep. I wish you well. It is a very troubled world out there. I reckon that I would have been pressed as a young officer, or in a place where you would be now, to be able to get my mind around some of the challenges that you face. I sense you're up for the task. You just have to prove it, and I'll be dead. Thank you.